Welcome to the city. I'm Anthony Wilson, the Public Information Officer for the City of San Angelo. And joining us for the full episode today is the President of Angelo State University, Dr. Brian May. Dr. May, thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Anthony. Glad to be here.
You know, later this year, you're going to celebrate your fifth anniversary as the President of Angelo State. What is it that you're most proud of to date in your time in that job?
Well, I think, you know, I'm just proud of the growth that we've been able to accomplish and the successes we've had. You know, there's been some failures in a few areas. For the most part, we've been wildly successful. You know, and if I were to mine down into that, you know, some experiences, bringing engineering to Angelo State University was a game changer for the school. That really does kind of put us on par with a lot of the other, what I would call, comprehensive regional institutions. And for personal accomplishments, I think naming the what we call the Center for Human Performance for Ben Kelly, that to me was one of the things that stick out to me. He was the first African American to play college football in the state of Texas, and he was right here in San Angelo. And a gentleman that dedicated his life to others, and he came back and spent 40 years working in the Boys and Girls Homes here in San Angelo, and so Boys and Girls Club. And so we were able to get that done before he passed away, and he got to enjoy that and his family. So I would say if I were to look at two accomplishments, that would be a couple of them. There's others to go along with that, but obviously, neither one of them reside with me as an individual. We did it together as a school.
You mentioned about the growth, and Angelo State is now rapidly approaching a long-held goal of having an enrollment of 10,000 students. That's growth of about 3,000 students since you began in this job. What's been the key to that growth?
Well, it's two different things. One, of course, is the strategy we took with dual credit. And that was something that's been primarily held with community colleges. And so it was a strategy that we took that we wanted to be a part of that and a part of that market and a part of that niche. And what we did was started going to different school districts around West Texas and, you know, telling them, you know, that we would like to be their partner. And in doing so, those students will still be charged a tuition as they were with the college partner they had before, but we give them a scholarship so that it's free to the student. And of course, that was a real selling point to not only to the superintendents, but the school boards of these local school districts. So that added a lot of students there. You know, our largest one is in Friendship High School at Lubbock. We have, you know, right here in San Angelo, as well as other school districts around West Texas, we go as far east as Glen Rose, Texas, and then we go down south to Del Rio. And so, it's I think, a real opportunity for us to develop feeder schools coming into Angelo State. Our true freshman on campus has grown, and this year was our largest freshman class. I give most of that credit to our new admissions staff that's headed up by Sharla Adam. She was a graduate of Angelo State herself, taught in our communications and mass media department for many years, and she helped get the Children's Miracle Network started for Shannon Hospital. We luckily hired her back, and she has transformed the recruiting aspects that we have over there. She has a lot of good colleagues that work with her. Jeff Sefcik and Susie Dushek and some others, and Carrie Mikulik. And they're just really, really dedicated folks, and they have got our story out to prospective seniors. And so we now have the largest population living on campus we've ever had at Angelo State. Those two things, along with the growth of the graduate school. And really what we did there was take away some barriers that were there for incoming graduate students, but also we put a lot of those programs completely online, and that has just exploded. We went over 1,500 students in graduate school this spring, and that's a record for Angelo State. But we've had double-digit semesters in a row of record enrollment in graduate school.
So assuming that you are going to reach that goal of 10,000 students next mm-hmm. fall, what becomes the goal after that?
Well, I don't think you stop. The thing about the state of Texas is that the universities who and institutions of higher education, the only way they can continue to make progress, to make improvements, to add more technologies, more programs, hire more faculty, are the institutions that are growing. And so, to me, there's no ceiling. And so we got to keep that momentum going. I really believe that we're a destination now, not a default. And I think, with our incredible ability to recruit students through the Carr Foundation and the low cost, last spring we had over right at 40% of our graduates graduated with no debt. So I think that's significant that we get that out there.
How much capacity do you have for growth here when you look at the physical property and your facilities?
Well, the thing about it is that, so many of our students are not on campus. As I told you, at the graduate level, we have a lot of them are completely online. And a big portion of our current students as well are in high schools taking dual credit. So we could grow quite a bit more and have that capacity. But we are preparing ourselves for that. We used to require up to 60 hours to move off campus. Now we only require 30 hours. And this semester we tweaked it even further that they only have to be on campus two long semesters. And so we think that's important for them to be able to acculturate themselves, and we know we get a lot better retention rate. But we're also building more dorms. This building we're sitting in now, we're building a new wing onto it starting in March. It'll be at another 162 beds.
So I remember when I first came to San Angelo in 2004, mm-hmm. and it seemed to me that Angelo State was more of a commuter college. I mean, mm-hmm. Students would sort of parachute in for the day for their classes right. and then leave. And now it seems like you have a real campus community that's developed here at Angelo State. To what do you attribute that change in culture?
I think you may have heard it, but we call it Ram Fam. But it's no more than a slogan. It's a culture here. We try to embrace the students. We try to tell them about student life and how they can stay here. And we've seen a rapid increase in the amount of students who stay on campus through the weekends, who come to our athletic events, and we have great facilities for our student athletes. They go to our performance events, be it through drama or choir or whatever in the fine arts. But they also just really like being on campus, and the campus has changed. When I was a student here at Angelo State, the entries we would have in the library might be several thousand a week. Well, now they're in double-digit thousand a day. The library is completely different. It's not about the volumes we hold in books. It's really about communal studying facilities they have in there, about individual private areas for them to study. We even have a Starbucks in our library. Used to, if you tried to take something to drink in the library, they would tackle you within 10 feet of the door. But now, not only is it celebrated, it's embraced. And so we have the largest Starbucks in San Angelo in our university center. We have a Chick-fil-A. We have, Subway. We have, you can have sushi three times a day. It's different. The millennials are different, but they want their amenities, and we provide it for them. And our dorms are wildly popular and acceptable. We have many students who stay in a dorm till they graduate. So I would say the combination of all of that is you're starting to see a lot more kids on campus. We have a lot of people in the community that come up here and walk at nighttime down the mall that goes through the whole length of the campus. And when they do, they see hundreds of students walking along with them. And so it's a vibrant campus, and it's a beautiful campus.
If someone were to ask you, what is Angelo State's signature degree program, what would you tell them?
Well, we commonly advertise our centers of excellence, but those three are nursing, education, teacher education, and agriculture. And it's because of the resources we have in those different areas. But we also have an undergraduate physics program that would rank in the top 10 in the United States. We have a great beginning engineering program. But I would say even in our liberal arts, communication, English and history, as well as our fine arts, are very vibrant, viable programs. We don't have any programs right now that are struggling. But our centers of excellence are those three, and it's primarily because of the resources. San Angelo is a regional medical center, so nursing and physical therapy are thrust into that center of support. Agriculture, the Concho Valley is an agrarian society, and we have a 6,000-acre ranch out right outside of town. It would be coveted by major land-grant universities. No regional institution can even come close to what we have in the infrastructure that we have in agriculture, with our meats laboratory, with our range and wildlife laboratories, with our hands-on with farm animals and ranch animals. And then for education, we supply the teachers for West Texas. Well, all over Texas, all over the nation. But we are a premier in that, and we have received a lot of accolades in that regard. But we also supply the accountants. We supply the business folks, the finance, management, marketing. We have a great business school, and it's on a rocket right now as far as enrollment. And I give a lot of that credit to the new dean, Clifton Jones, that we brought in from the University of South Carolina. And he's just done an amazing job.
We're talking with Dr. Brian May. He is the president of Angelo State University, and we'll be back right after this. Ever seen the Facebook meme in which Abraham Lincoln warns not to believe everything you see on the internet? Turns out, Honest Abe was right. Exhibit A, the news report circulating online from San Angelo Live and former Houston TV reporter Wayne Dulcifino. In those stories, Live and Dulcifino take the city of San Angelo to task over whether a final audit was completed regarding Republic Services overcharging commercial customers under a prior contract. Republic is the city's contracted garbage collector. In fact, an audit was completed during litigation and by an experienced expert authority. Gregory Shannabrook is a director in the Forensics Advisory Services practice for Grant Thornton LLP. That company is one of the planet's leading independent audit, tax, and advisory accounting firms. Mr. Shannabrook is a CPA and a certified fraud examiner. For the past 8 years, his work has focused on forensics accounting, namely corporate investigation, fraud examination, and damage calculations. He scrutinized Republic's commercial customer billing from August 1, 2004 through June 30, 2014. He found more than $5.2 million in total refundable fees that should be returned to those commercial customers. After adding associated franchise fees, sales tax, and interest, Shannabrook concluded the total amount due to commercial customers was nearly $6.5 million. The forensics accountant outlined in exacting detail the process he used to calculate that figure in a 63-page report. That document is part of a public record on file at the Tom Green County Courthouse. That file relates to a lawsuit that seeks the refund of the overcharges. The plaintiffs in that case have accepted the findings of the auditor. Incidentally, Republic asserts that more than 96% of the refund checks it has issued to commercial customers, totaling $6 million plus, have been cashed. The balance involves customers who cannot be located, presumably because those businesses have closed, moved, or changed ownership. San Angelo Live publisher Joe Hyde and Mr. Dulcifino have raised lots of questions about this audit. But here are some questions for them. How is it that two journalists who pride themselves on dogged investigative skills have been unable to unearth this audit? Again, the audit report is a public record on file as part of a lawsuit that's driving their reporting. If commercial entities that were overcharged have not been made whole financially, why haven't these two intrepid reporters been able to find them? Perhaps because there are none? The city hasn't been contacted by any business claiming it still owed money. Importantly, who's bankrolling the work of Dolcifino Consulting? Mr. Dolcifino bills himself on his website as, quote, one of the most feared names in Texas television. Again, I'm quoting, Wayne doesn't shy away from making news when his clients want a public fight. They don't call it wartime communications for nothing. And when you hire Wayne Dolcifino and Dolcifino Consulting, you get instant media attention. Further, he notes the, quote, permanent damage social media can inflict outside of traditional journalism. His website also says, quote, his company will fight just as hard to honor client confidentiality, and I will not name names. Even so, we pose to him the same questions he's asked us. Don't our citizens have the right to know? In this case, who's behind his efforts? The community has repeatedly seen the vendor who failed to win the landfill and garbage contracts continually stir public sentiment against Republic and the services it provides. That vendor is a frequent advertiser on the San Angelo Live website. Its owner is regularly quoted in live stories about trash service, usually without any attempt to provide balance by offering the city's point of view. Not coincidentally, one of the plaintiffs in the lawsuit against Republic is a subsidiary of that vendor. If Mr. Dolcifino is working on behalf of the plaintiffs, surely he and San Angelo Live must know of the completed audit and of the plaintiff's acceptance of the findings in it. If he is truly seeking truth, wouldn't he have requested interviews with the city's public servants rather than stalking them in parking lots? Maybe that fact-based reporting wouldn't fit Mr. Dolcifino's narrative. Maybe it doesn't yield the clickbait for which Mr. Hyde yearns. Maybe it doesn't make for the, quote, wartime communications, permanent damage, and public fight for which Mr. Dolcifino is itching. At least not like chasing people through parking lots, shoving cameras in faces, and telling half-baked stories. Those tactics may play well in Houston. But any reasonable San Angeloan can agree that when Mr. Dolcifino requests emails between a city official and a personal friend in hopes of embarrassing that public servant, he's crossed a line. Like Mr. Dolcifino, I too had a long career in journalism. My understanding of the craft is this: its purpose is to illuminate through light, not to ignite with heat. What we're seeing on the internet isn't meant to shine a ray of truth. It's simply meant to watch us burn. Welcome back. We are continuing our conversation with the president of Angelo State University, Dr. Brian May. Dr. May, what are your expectations regarding state funding for higher education and for Angelo State in particular, given that it looks like it's going to be a pretty tight budget for the state in the coming biennium?
It is, you know, and the sentiment in Austin is that they want to continue to cut taxes as well as put up more funding for a rainy day. They call it the rainy day fund or economic stabilization fund. Well, in those two aspects alone leaves tighter and tighter, you know, parameters for us to look at as far as funding for higher education, certainly K through 12. You have huge demands in Medicare and Medicaid on the state, you know, and we've talked a lot about Child Protective Services. Certainly they're going to need their funding, and you know, the prison system, it's just ongoing, you know, infrastructure and transportation needs. So when they look at higher ed, you know, they look at it from the fact that, well, you know, you're doing okay, but in reality we're not. The situation is that 70% of our budget used to come from state funding. Now it's much less than 50. It might be even half that in the 30s. So, you know, there's been a lot of media release about, you know, what universities have done in increasing tuition and tuition costs. Well, that was a direct relationship to the decrease in state funding. I will say this, that probably Drew Darby is the best man we could ever have in Austin at this point in time. He does an outstanding job. He understands state resources. He understands the budget. And he has a lot of say in Austin. And so I trust, you know, what he's going to be able to get done. But we are bracing ourselves for a cut. And 2 years ago, we were able to get funding for a new building and some additional funding in the state support of tuition and fees. But their support, although it was phenomenal, the amount of money they put into it, we had grown as a state so much, and the population in higher ed had grown so much that it only equaled out to a 1% increase. Well, that doesn't even keep up with inflation. So that's why I'm going back to what you and I started off this conversation. Do you want to keep growing? You have to, you know, because if you want to continue to give your faculty salary increases, if you want to continue to make improvements to your delivery and your infrastructure, you have to grow. And what that does is that lowers the cost per student for the fixed cost if you can have a bigger population. And kind of boiling that all down is that we don't want to raise tuition anymore. We had to do it some, especially like 6 or 7 years ago, but since then it's been incremental to no increase. In fact, we tell students that we cap your fees at 12 hours. So if you'll take 15, 18, even 20 hours, you get a lot bigger bang for your buck. And we're doing that by throwing that in there, giving the free housing for summer school. So the state is doing what they can. I'm proud that we live in a balanced budget state. I love that fact. I hear a lot of horror stories from other states where higher ed has been slashed dramatically. And so to me, even though we're probably going to take a cut, I think the state of Texas does it as good as they can with what they have to work with in order to maintain higher ed quality.
How would you characterize the relationship between the community of San Angelo and Angelo State University, and how important is that to your success?
Well, it's incredibly important. And I can tell you, we have a very vibrant international student population on this campus, primarily from the country of Korea. It's been primarily stimulated by a faculty member that we have here that's taking it upon himself. In fact, we've readjusted his his assignment at Angelo State for that purpose. And so what happened was is that San Angelo helps us with those international students in the way of transportation, making them feel at home. This campus is surrounded by churches. We love that part too, because they reach in and help us with any time we need help. But the outpouring of support that I've had personally these last 4 years has been nothing short of phenomenal. We've raised about $47 million in private funds for academic programs and for student programs, athletics, and other things to help us revitalize our facilities, paying for faculty salaries, new research equipment, and it's been overwhelming. And when I talk to other regional institution presidents here in this state, they don't even come close. They don't even come close. San Angelo has supported us to a level that really rivals major institutions. And in fact, our development officer, Jamie Aiken, who is the vice president of development, she's received the top award from higher ed development for the entire southwestern United States the last 3 years in a row. So it is excruciatingly important. And because I can tell you that the parents of these children that we have on this campus, if they've told me once, they've told me 1,000 times how much they love coming to San Angelo and how friendly our people are and how much everyone cares about our institution. We're this sleepy little campus between College Hills and Santa Rita that a lot of times they drive by it and they don't even think. But right now, we have so many people on campus, it's hard to cross Avenue Inn unless you're at a stoplight. It's different, and it will continue to change. But I think the support will continue to be there.
You recently announced a partnership with Shannon Medical Center.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to talk a little bit about that.
That was what we started off with 3 years ago was to have a request for bid proposal of our on-campus clinic to ask a partner. And so we put that out to hospitals all over. And of course, Shannon was one who won that bid. And what it did was it made it to where our students can go anywhere in town to a Shannon urgent care clinic using their photo ID, and the services are completely free. And we supply the transportation at night and weekends for our students. We call it Ramtram. And so that worked out so well, and it saved us an incredible amount of money that we took that money and plowed it back into counseling services, which has the demand for that has grown dramatically, mainly because of the culture of the generation we have. It's increased across the country. So then we looked at the next phase, or the next real demand for medical care is in the student athlete and sports medicine. That's a huge expense for us. We make sure that every student athlete is made whole. You know, if there is insurance, we'll use it, but if there's not, we owe it to that student athlete to make that whole. And so we decided to have another request for bid, and that went out this year. And Shannon got that bid as well. And in that bid, it was a stipulation that you had to build the sports medicine clinic adjacent to the Janelle Center, Stevens Arena, so that it would be easy access for our, and it would also house our athletic training. And so with that, we were able to double the space that we have for athletic training. But inside that facility, there'll be an orthopedic surgeon office. There'll also be Shannon's capacity for physical therapy. And so it's just a win-win for everyone. It'll cut our costs dramatically for sports medicine, but obviously that'll be swallowed up with other athletics expenses.
So what do you like about working here?
I like working here because, you know, I went to school here, and I followed my brother here, and my two sisters followed me. I met my wife here. She graduated from Angelo State. My oldest daughter attended here. My youngest daughter graduated from here, and so did both my son-in-laws. And I'm a one-school president. I'm not going anywhere. If I'm not president at Angelo State, then I'll go back to teaching. But I love this school. And so I can't wait to get here every morning. I get here between 6 and 6:30 every morning. And my vice president, he comes in and drinks coffee with me at 7. And we start talking about what we're doing, whether it's, and I try to emulate my mentor, Dr. Vincent. You know, I pay attention to the trees, I pay attention to the sidewalks, you know, but we're constantly looking at what we can do to improve it. So I enjoy this job a lot, but I think as I would emulate what the parents and students say, it's because of the people. I just love the people we have working here, and I enjoy being around students. I still teach a class every year, and it's like a drug to go into the first day of class, and I can't give that up. And so that's all part of what I am.
One last question.
Okay.
You know I'm an Aggie.
Yes.
What do you think about this tie?
I love it. I mean, you're riding for the brand. You know, and I wear a lot of yellow and blue ties myself. But, you know, I graduated from from Angelo State, but I did graduate with my PhD from A&M, but the only diplomas hanging in my office are the ones from Angelo State. And so that's just where I am.
We've been talking with Dr. Brian May. He is the president of Angelo State University, and we hope you'll join us for the next episode of The City.